Are you working on your author career but struggling to get that first book published? Does the goal of being an author seem too lofty? Or are thoughts of having multiple books and making a full-time living are as fantastical as living in Cinderella's castle? Welcome to Discovered Wordsmiths, a podcast where aspiring authors can be heard. Join Stephen Schneider as he finds and talks to authors you may not know, but authors that have gotten their foot on the author career path. Hear what they've done to get there and where they want to go now. Settle back. It's time for a bit of inspiration and advice. Come listen to today's Discovered Wordsmith.
Hey, welcome to episode 55 of Discovered Wordsmiths. Today is a really fun episode. I'm talking to another avid reader, someone who considers themselves a whale reader that reads tons and tons of stuff all the time. Everything from fiction, nonfiction, to comic books. He is Alan Baltus. He's also my buddy on and co-host on Relentless Geekery podcast. If you're interested in geek talk and topics that nerds would love, check out Relentless Geekery. This episode actually is also one of our episodes at Relentless Geekery, but I am going to focus on all the things about reading that Alan talks about. He's read tons of books and just hundreds and hundreds of things all the time. We talk books on our geek podcast constantly. So sit back, have a listen to a reader that really, really, really enjoys reading and has a very large list of interests in that, in those reading topics. So it's a fun time, good talk, and I hope you enjoy it.
Do something like this.
Oh yeah.
Because we're going to do books today for the first part, and that looks makes me look all kind of bookish. So, okay, let's try that. Yes, there's the Baltus Library. Actually, it's not tall enough. It has to have one of those. It does have a rolling ladder. What am I saying?
It does have a ladder, yeah.
Exactly. So, yeah, that really was a fantasy of mine early on, by the way, to have the big library with all those bookshelves and the rolling ladder. And especially, you have to have the globe, the freestanding globe that's big, like in Pink Panther movies, big, where you can right. Like spin it and get your hand caught in it. and it could also be that it flips open and that's where you keep your brandy and your snifters too. I've seen that.
Yes. In movies, you know. So I always thought with the Kindle or any of the ebook stuff that they should create the interface so it looks like a giant library. So you're like can move around the library and you touch it and the book comes out or something like that, you know?
There's actually one called Delicious Library. That's its default format for showing your collections is not a listing in a spreadsheet. It's showing your books on a shelf and that's your cool. Video. It does multiple things. So you can see your video games and CDs and it actually does have, you know, of course, different icons so that they look like the right size and comparison right. Between. So I don't know. It just seemed it can't be the most efficient way to do it if you're really looking right. For something quickly. But when I go to the bookstore, that's how I do it is I kind of browse through and you let your eyes unfocus and go to what have I not seen before? And they've got all their suggestive selling of the ones that are faced outwards to you are the ones that paid the $10,000 fee to get, right. You know, a shelf placement and stuff like that.
And so that's funny you say that because I know I've done that. You know, Gina and I are a used bookstore or a big bookstore or whatever. And I'm just standing there going zoom, zoom, zoom back and forth. She's like, how can you tell what you're seeing? I'm like, well, I kind of know the fonts and I guess the way the books look, you know, there's certain author names or whatever that I'm looking yes. For and it just ping my eye catches it every now and then I'll miss something, but quite often.
Exactly. Especially if you, I mean, I've done that for decades. And like you just said, most used bookstores, they don't do any of the facing of covers. It really is just. And so if anything, your mind is working again in the background where, okay, where am I? I'm in the F's. So who am I thinking that I like reading that's in the right. F's? Frasier or whatever, you know what I mean? And then. Right. It's you let your, I don't know, there's like a sifting routine that your mind goes through that makes interesting things stand out or things that we're familiar with stand out. And I don't know, whatever things I miss by scanning quickly, I'm also like, well, geez, I can't be here for 5 hours reading, right. Really reading the spine of every single book here, right. You know? So
we've got a bookstore we like over in PA called Cupboard Maker Books. And it's also a cat shelter rescue. So as you're browsing the books, you have cats all over the place.
Yeah,
it is so big and so many books. The last time we went, we were there like 2 hours and we're going, yeah, we didn't have enough time.
you know?
Exactly. I've been, you know, when I've been to, what's the famous one in Portland? Powell's, I guess, right? Same thing.
Yeah.
I walked through the entire thing, and it's kind of funny, since we're going to be talking about being readers today, it isn't that I just go to, I'm a mystery guy, so I go to the mystery section. I'm like, so where's science fiction and fantasy? Where's mystery? Where's puzzles? Where's humor? I have, and just general fiction, sometimes it's like, well, I know that some of my favorite authors, they're not really genre, so I have to go look specifically for, and like Stephen King, sometimes regular, sometimes horror, whatever else it might be. I love big places like that because there's such a chance to explore, and especially when they really have years of books. You know, any store nowadays is based on turnover, and so even when you go to a Barnes & Noble or a Borders is defunct, sorry.
Yeah.
You know, and have more books to look at than you usually do, it's still, man, everything is 3 years old, maybe, and they might have certain authors that they have kind of complete sets, but it's very different than going to a used bookstore where I've been in a used book. Have you ever had this? I used to go into a used bookstore and I find books that I love and I'm like, well, I already have this, but I want to buy this to give it to somebody so I can say, you got to read this. It's great. Yeah.
Well, it's only $1.25. Oh my gosh, this is worth it.
Exactly. It's a perfect, you know.
I don't have this cover.
And boy, the first time that I was ever in Toronto, because I'm a geek, I went there for Toronto Macworld, and I had never, you know, it was great because I was able to drive up there, park my car, I stayed in the bed and breakfast, and then take public transit everywhere because it took me right to the convention center, and I learned enough about it to be able to go everywhere. Well, my difficulty was I'm in bookstores that I'd never been in before, and there's enough British infiltration in Canada that I was seeing series like, you know, Modesty Blaze or something like that, where they're really hard to find here in the States, but they had two dozen. And twice I walked home with like the plastic bags where the plastic handles are digging into your fingers, cutting off circulation, because I kept finding, you know, and in some cases I'm kind of a purist, if I already had some of the series in one format, I didn't want to get the next ones in the British format because the cover style didn't match or whatever. But I was like, well, now I know that these are already out, and how come they haven't been issued in the States yet? But I remember calling my parents, this is no lie, there's a place called Kohl's that was a city block of a bookstore. It was half a block, but two stories tall. So it just had, honestly, probably more books than I'd ever seen in one place. And I'm standing there, and like some places have a travel section or a humor section, and they had aisles of all this stuff. So I'm in the humor aisle, and I call my parents and say, thank you so much for making me a reader, because I'm just in the middle of Treasureville here. You know what I mean? And even though I knew I shouldn't be buying as more than I can carry, when am I going to be back in Toronto? When am I going to be back at this particular bookstore? Oh man, did I overdo it.
So let's delve into that a little bit. I mean, we could use this for both podcasts. You know, it's of interest to everybody. So you've read your whole life. I know that. What's your earliest memories of reading, and what you said your parents, you thank them. What got you into reading? Why is it so interesting to you?
Well, it definitely was, you know, my parents were good about reading to us when we were young. We had the Gold Key books and the, you know, whatever. I don't remember that much having Dr. Seuss, for instance, you know, which is such a primer for many. But my parents seemed to be, I don't know, maybe more European in their taste. And so we read Hans Christian Andersen. We read The Brothers Grimm and all kinds of other picture and story books. And I guess I was able to not only hear them read to me, but start to get it when I was quite young, which to the parents was interesting and amazing. But it was also then that when you're not only following along, but you're anticipating because you've heard the story so many times. Apparently, my favorite book when I was young was Darby O'Gill and the Little People.
Really?
And that's one of those things where whenever my mom would say, go get a book to read, I must have come back with that 90% of the time, because it had cool elves, and it had a big mountain of treasure, and it had, you know, a mystery of going through the caves and whatever else it might be. Somehow that was just incredibly attractive to me. But then after a while, I was like turning the pages for her because I knew the story. And I guess because I was able to read on my own relatively early, I was reading before I was in school. You know what I mean? My parents, and I don't know, I was already odd in that way. If I had a pretty big vocabulary and I could read on my own early, probably one of those things where I couldn't hold some of the books I was reading. You can't read the Encyclopedia Britannica when you can't hold the book. You know what I mean? So you had to put it out on the table.
And that's one of the best books, man. When I was little looking at that, it's like every page has something new.
Honestly, that really was the first rabbit hole experience where I'd be working on a report, probably, I don't know, third grade or something like that. And I'd go to look up about John Paul Jones. And then, of course, while you're there, you read other things that about him and that war. And then you're on the J page. And so it's like, well, what about John? And it was just, I remember kind of coming to and going, well, that was fun, but I'm not, my report isn't done yet.
Right, right.
I went to school, of course. And, you know, the teachers there would also, the class would read together, but sometimes they'd take individuals over and have them read to you. I think the one maybe was part of the accelerated class or something like that. And they would write down words that you didn't know and you'd take them home so your parents could help you with them and practice them and stuff like that. This is no lie. I had the word poo written, not because I didn't know it, but because I couldn't say it to the teacher. I just was so, polite and, silly child innocence. I couldn't let on that I knew what that word was. I'm all over the place because reading is fundamental. There's a great book called something like Words and Nouns. It's as basic as that, but it's by a guy named Steven Pinker, who does studies of how the brain works. And what he goes into is how, when you see how people, we really have a language instinct. It's very in us as social animals to learn language and to see kids struggle with how many rules there are and how many exceptions to rules there are, is to understand how cool language is. So when you have, bring, brang, brung, and think, thank, thunk, no, you didn't think it, you thought it, that you get all the ways in which, like you were saying about certain verbs, intransitive verbs, etc., you really have to memorize them as much as learn the patterns, because the patterns will fail you right when it really matters. You know what I mean? And it's a fascinating book because it really goes, it's loaded with those examples that I know when I was young, I must have laughed at. Oh, I thought it was very funny to say I thunk it. You know what I mean? That it was just, it's kind of correct in my kid mind. And the teacher gets to correct you, but laugh at the fact that you could even think the wrong way in the right way. You know what I mean? It's really cool.
And how many times you question, you're taught something, you're like, but wait a second, I thought the rule was this, and how come it doesn't? And it's like, stop questioning, just do it this way.
Right. And as you know, nowadays on the net, they have all the wonderful things of, I before E, except after C, except the weird way that neighbor, and then they have like seven of the exceptions listed. And I kind of want to like memorize those because I love the overwhelm of it, but it's the fact that there's so many, like the O-U-G-H thing, the tough coughs while he plows the trough, and it's all, there's seven different ways of saying this same letter sequence. And so I've always loved that kind of stuff. I loved wordplay, and I guess it's not only puns, it's all those various different things. When you start reading about literary devices, like here's where a part of the body stands for the body, how many, what's your head count? And of course you're counting people, But, and Colleen's really good about that. She knows about zeugma. She can like name, that's the one where you voluntarily get it wrong for effect. You're like, I don't know, here's a paraprosdokian. What that means is it's a down the garden path statement. So it's when you say a joke, a nice terse joke, a two-liner, that the first joke sets it up and the second part of the joke turns left. It like creates an expectation, then violates it, but so quickly that you get that wonderful little jolt of surprise and like a giggle laughter instead of a bellow, because you're just pleased that someone thought about that. So it's the, outside of a dog, a book's your best companion. Inside of a dog, it's too dark to read.
Right.
And that's Groucho. You know what I mean? How there's so many great ones like that. Emo Phillips is great at those. Anyway, I love when there's those kinds of one and two liners where how much mirth, how much pithy, perfect humor did you pack into just 15 words?
And just using the differences in words and how they sound, but different meanings, or the same word with completely different meanings.
Exactly. A friend on Facebook, Kevin Schwartz, is like a modern practitioner of that. He's a stand-up comedian, but regularly tries out jokes on the net. And I must not just like, but laugh half the time, because he's an unending fountain of another cool slight abuse of that phenomenon. It means the same, but two different contexts, or it means two different things depending on spelling, or he's just, the fact that he keeps finding them. In fact, another Richard Lederer, another Mensen, he made a whole career out of writing great books about all those fun little English irregularities and fun things to know. So here's all the ways in which we name groups of animals. And so it's not just a flock applies to all birds. There's all the different, it's a murder of crows. It's an exaltation of larks. And you know what I mean? And it's kind of funny, even before Richard Lederer, I was aware of that because Tony Randall used to go on Johnny Carson, and he often, his segment would be, he'd pull a little list out of his pocket and say, you know, I just happened to have been reading a little bit and I was wondering, and he would quiz Johnny. And one of the ways in which you got to know that Johnny wasn't just a comedian, but actually was a very sharp guy, was how often he would know that it's, you know, a crash of rhinos or something like that.
Right.
Like, when does that come up in conversation? You know, you have to kind of be well-read or quirky-read, where you look for those kinds of things and remember them. And so I that was an early thing of, you know, I kind of want to learn a lot of those, you know?
right. I remember once something, it was like some special book or something coming out, and we were trying to get there and get a copy. And we're sitting in the car, it's cold, we're waiting, and it's like almost time for the store to open. So you like see all these people getting out of their cars and walking to the store. And it's like, you know, a mass exodus towards the store. Yeah. And my daughter looks up and goes, oh, wow, look, it's a flurry of nerds. I'm like, oh, that's perfect. I love that. So it's a flurry of nerds.
And actually, one of the joys, no lie, of language is you get to coin your own words or coin your own uses. So Colleen has talked about, like, for nerds or Mensens, it's either a hug of Mensens or it's a convolution of Mensens, because depending on in what context, that really, really matches, you know.
And like Colin always says, every word was made up at some point.
Exactly.
So let me ask you this. So it's very obvious. You don't just read one style, one thing. You read all over the board, fiction, nonfiction. Obviously, it's exciting. We love talking about some of that stuff. What would you say are your, besides nonfiction, what are your favorite fiction genres and what attracts you to those?
So one thing I've noticed about myself is I really love serial fiction. I love it where it's not just a one shot and there's that great joy while you're reading it, but there's a little bit of, oh, it's over when you're done. So when I first started to read comic books or things that the story went on, that really created in me that desire to say, well, what happens over time? What's going to happen to that character? How about someone who goes away for a while and the story weaves back in? And so the genres that seem to embrace that are science fiction, often has not only standalone books, but trilogies and pentologies, and if that's the right word, you know, but I really like where there's more to it, that the world keeps expanding and there's unexplored parts of the map and that kind of thing. I really like where there's recurring characters. And so mysteries often have a lot of that. There's a whole bunch of Hercule Poirot books. You know, there's a whole bunch of where you get to see, I really like the Spencer series. And he really goes through some changes over the course of his 50 books now. I think that most of them by the real Robert B. Parker, but now written by various different ghosts, all of whom really seem to have captured the essence of what it was to make a good Spencer book. And so that thing of the ongoing story, I really like that. There's some books that are really perfect and pithy, and I'm satisfied with that, but I've noticed that I really graduate towards that. And in fact, one of the my little software projects that has never come to fruition, but I've often thought about, is NITS, next in the series, something that specializes in, if you're reading a series and you want to know what's the next book in this series, so it's important to read them in order. You know what I mean? My God, to read The Lord of the Rings 1 and 3 and skip 2. It's like, well, what about all the cool stuff that led to this? And also that you want a good recommendation engine so that you know if you like this author, you'll probably like this guy. Humor even has some things like, if you like, it's not a matter of the characters created, but the author's style. Some people, I just love how they write. So Dave Barry just cracks me up. Terry Pratchett cracks me up. There are certain things that they have such a joy of language, such a sense of the absurd, and of, like, sometimes it's really punchy jokes. Sometimes it's a wonderful slow build up, and then they really pants you with a great joke that you didn't see coming. You know what I mean? Piers Anthony used to have, like, every book title of his was a pun. And so it's like, I'm kind of in. I want to know what in the world, how does he do that? I also know that there's certain people that I don't read serially. I like to, like Terry Pratchett, he has a very specific, that's the right way to put it, a sense of humor that is distinctive enough, and the books are so funny, but if you read a bunch of them in a row, I notice that it's kind of like pushing that button to get a food pellet again and again. After a while, you need more. And I don't like to be addicted. I don't like to not find it funny, because my brain is kind of like tuned now to this sense of humor. So I see things coming. I tend to make sure I read those with some time in between, so that the humor interpreting part of my brain gets a chance to rest, and it gets to be re-surprised, and the re-expectation of he's really good at that kind of stuff. Right.
Plus, it also, we've talked before, when your brain thinks about it subconsciously, you tend to appreciate it more. You analyze it a little bit. You get things you didn't get before. It kind of ferments almost and grows to something new and better.
Exactly. And that's something that's kind of out of line with how people do things nowadays, that oftentimes they'll binge TV and they'll watch like all 10 episodes of a show, whereas I tend to sprinkle between multiple shows. I watch them. And so I, like you said, I get a chance for my brain to say, so what's really going on there? And who really might be behind the plot? And you know what I mean? Are they really in love, or whatever else it might be? And so with books, it's almost kind of automatically a thing like that. Authors can only churn them out so quickly. Right. And so there's automatically a delay. And some part, I've always loved this, that when you can read a series that it doesn't even have like a recap at the start, sometimes they do that, but you just kind of go back in. And then every time that you read another character, it's not another, it's like, oh yeah, that was the guy that was the thief that was jailed for a while. But you know what I mean? And it's like, you get to, it's cool to be aware that your mind from, wow, 2 years ago, it actually, each of those little threads is being pulled up and you're rearranging it into, now I'm getting what's going on. And so it's very satisfying in some ways. And of course, some people abuse that, you know, when you're looking for the next book and it's 10 years in between, like George R.R. Martin. Or, you know what I mean? Or who did Patrick Rothfuss, you know what I mean? He wrote a great book called The Name of the Wind, but now in the second book, and now the second and a half kind of novella. But you know, I'm like, well, that's a dissatisfying thing now. There's such pent-up demand and so much time in between that I don't know I'm going to get satisfied that I finally get to read it. But there's a little bit of pissedness over, you know, I don't know, it's there's a deal between authors and their fan base.
Right.
To hook them, if you're writing a series that's meant to hook them, then you can't abuse that. You can't, like, right, leave you high and dry for years and years. Exactly. And I read good refutations to that. You know, there's an author has no obligation to his fans whatsoever. He could work on a different genre, a different book, abandon the project entirely if it doesn't satisfy him anymore. He can, but I really appreciate the ones that, wow, they started with a big vision and they kept going. And it wasn't just like, I don't know, chugging through it. And there's some authors that after a while, they're not hacks, but they're a little bit more predictable over the course of time, whatever that, right. That maybe it's, you know, they often talk about the first book that you read, that person has loved it, lived it, tuned it for many, many years. And then if it's successful, of course, you know, the commerce world comes and says, hey, if you have a sequel, you can make some more money.
Right.
And then they don't have 10 years to do it. They really do only have one or two. And so
or less.
The same level of quality, unless a person is really where they've mapped out an entire thing and they said, if this takes off, I got 10 books in me. And sometimes you see that, you know what I mean? That there's, anyway, because I read serial fiction, it's also kind of a weird thing to be like, some things aren't just a trilogy. You know, there's 600 Shadow books. There's 180 Doc Savages. There's something like 2000 Perry Rodans. Wow. You know what I mean?
Like Bolin and Executioner. And
exactly that. The Menzit Boy. I read The Executioner and The Destroyer and The Death Merchant growing up. How did I turn out to be a relatively decent human being when everything was about, need a solution for that? Here it is. Blam, blam, blam.
Maybe your split personality is just hiding that from you.
You know, I kind of, if ever things really went to hell and the mafia killed my family, I know what I would do. I wouldn't say, oh gosh. I'd be like, how many of them can I kill before they take me down?
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Keanu Reeves them.
Yes, exactly.
So let me ask, what don't you like to read? Have you picked up a book or a series or an author and you've read some, you're like, yeah, this just isn't for me. You know, what don't you like?
Yeah. So that's a great question. There's only been certain, like one of the dissatisfying things, if you're a serial reader, is you buy all three books with the expectation of good. I got some good reading ahead of me. So there was one series by, like, for instance, the Stephen Donaldson books. Thomas Covenant, the Unbeliever. Yes. I plowed through like three 600-page books And I, at the end, it was like, God, some great ideas, but so much. This went nowhere. This was dissatisfying. The hero wasn't heroic enough. Whatever the flouting of the conventions of the genre that he was doing, they weren't just like slight tweaks. They were like, well, this just really isn't. And so I disrecommend those to anybody. If you're looking for like a better book, you know what I mean? There's all kinds of things. I love heroic fiction. I really, from comic books and from various different things, I like seeing where people have a difficult job ahead of them and they somehow, you know, the hero's journey, a young man grows into the man he has to be in order to solve this. The young woman, same thing. They gain powers, they gain knowledge, they make big choices that are going to matter. Especially if you're reading young, that's kind of what you're thinking about is, if I'm in that situation, would I be able to be as brave, as heroic, as thoughtful in those
Keanu
ways.
Reeves.
As Keanu Reeves. Exactly. Kill my dog. I got a whole bunch of bullets for you. You know, that kind of thing. So I read a series. A lot of times, one of the things after you've read a lot of books is, you know that there's like 36 basic plots. And when I have read something that really seemed to be very derivative, very going nowhere, after the first 100 pages, there was a series by Constantine, I think. And they were just, he did so much kind of random world building. The characters were unlikable. There just was, you know, even though I bought these three books, I kind of don't want to invest the time. My time is now more valuable than having to see what happens. That's part of probably why I'm a serial fiction is that, you know, sometimes you really have to see it to the end. You know, I don't know that I'm the best at getting to the finish line of a 100-yard dash, but I'm always standing at the end of, you know, so I really like that satisfaction of I stuck it out. And some are so bad that they really aren't worth that. I don't tend to read a lot of true crime and like exploitative things. As much as I just talked about heroic fiction, often the villain is really villainous and they really have, you know, made up things, but somehow reading about how bad people really can be, it's just, I don't know that I want to know that about the world. So I don't read serial killer biographies. You know what I mean? I kind of don't want to know how. I guess I kind of avoid things that I don't want to think the worst about the world. When I read history, there's all kinds of, as you might imagine, war and conflict and so forth. But I don't know that I want to read about death camps, about the worst things that have happened. I don't need to read any more about the Khmer Rouge. And I don't know if I'm saying that correct. There's one that I don't know that I've heard said out loud, where, wow, how did humanity let that happen for as long? You know what I mean? I don't want to read about terrible things. I don't want books to put images in my mind that I can never get out. You know what I mean?
And right. TV it's okay. Is
worse than that, you know?
It's okay if it's dragons doing it.
I guess. Whatever remove you need, whatever ability to push it aside and say, well, that couldn't really happen. And so even as awful as it was written, the dragon did indeed melt the guy alive in his armor. You know what I mean? Oh, it's a dragon. You know what I mean? Right, there's no way that can happen, both for books and for any kind of media. So I tend to have maybe what's my motivating, what's the drug that my body produces that I most enjoy? And I like serotonin, where it's the pleasure drug. I like various different tastes. I don't know that I'm an adrenaline junkie.
Do you read nowadays mostly old stuff that you've read before or authors you know, or are you looking for new books, new authors? You know, how do you balance that? Decide, what are your habits?
Right. So it really is a balancing act. When I discover an author that I like, I tend to read everything that they've done, you know, and so sometimes they've done numbers in the same series. Sometimes they've branched out. They've done multiple things. When I scan those bookshelves in the way that we've talked about, I look for authors with whom I am familiar, and it's kind of like, well, I read all the Heinlein, and Heinlein's gone, and he's not making any more. So there's a cap on that, if you will. However, I'm always looking for new books and looking for, like, in my genres, I'm as susceptible to a good pull quote as anybody else, and to a convincing cover, and to like the whatever the back page summary is of, okay, it's got palace intrigue and maybe a little bit of magic, and it's got, you know, really I don't know, conflict within the family and stuff like that. And so there's certain things, I don't know that I look specifically for them, but I do have a set of check boxes that say, well, this will be complex, it'll be like, and I guess I have a real novelty gene in me. I really like variety. And so if I've read I don't know, how many quest books can you read where there's a specific MacGuffin that people are trying to get, and whether it's a cup or, you know, a special right. book or whatever else it might be. But if it is something new, like here's a whole new world that seems to be, the world is 98% covered by water and islands are really valuable. It's like, well, let's explore that. I really would like to see how that plays out. Or a desert world like Dune, or a, everything is telepathic. You know what I mean? It's not just human beings are the dominant intellectual force on the planet. Though, of course, there are dolphins and crows and white mice. You know what I mean? They're pan-dimensional, hyper-intelligent beings, according to Douglas. And so I really like seeing where they've, science fiction especially is great with, let's take this idea and run with it and just see where it goes. And so what if there was teleportation? What if there was unlimited sources of energy? What if we reached other planets? And my curiosity is just so wonderfully sated by that kind of thing that that's probably where I try the most new authors, is because they seem to have a new idea. You know what I mean? Maybe if Heinlein went back to Mars again and again, well, I kind of want to read something beyond Mars. What if you had to live on a gas giant? What would be the bubble you'd live in that was... I also, it's kind of funny, I am happily satisfied with the number of times of, well, this looks cool. You know, there's some series where the marketeers said, what are the covers that will attract undue attention, that if we can just get people to say, this looks cool, how do you really judge a 300-page book from a pull quote and a good cover? And yet, if it's got Frazetta on the cover, I'm like, well, at least they know what people like in the genre. If they got Boris Vallejo, if they got, you know, various different great cover artists that I like. One of the reasons that I loved Doc Savage growing up was not only that I liked the heroic fiction of it, it's that the covers looked fantastic. They were ultra realistic. James Bama was the artist, you know, and that Widow's Peak plus the jodhpurs and the torn shirt, a very distinctive connecting look between the books. And that always the cover, I've heard any number of books where the cover was like, well, that scene doesn't even occur in the book. What kind of, you know, bait and switch was that? That instead they really were indicative of the book, like what was going to be the mystery, the menace, the thing. I also love this kind of, bookstores are good for this, but even on Amazon, they've tried to put in recommendation engines where they say, hey, if you liked Jim Butcher, you might like this guy. And so I've tried to make sure that I've gone through, and not only have I bought things, but over the course of time, I've kind of said, I like this and this and this. I follow these various different authors. And any number of times they've popped up with, you know, if you like, I just discovered a series by Greg Hurwitz that was about like an assassin that couldn't stand being an assassin anymore, so became the nowhere man. Now he helps people, but he's got all of his assassin tradecraft, so he stays off the grid and stuff like that. And I'm pretty sure I don't know that I ever would have picked it out, except that Amazon said, hey, by the way, if you like that, you might like this. And then I look, and it's like, well, it's 5 books in. Yes, it's not a standalone.
Right.
And so they lured me in. Exactly. And in fact, that's now led to another one that's called The Gray Man comic books. We haven't even talked about that. Did you know?
No. And I was going to get to that. But let me ask this, because I know what you mean. And I think two things you talked about. Series, I think, is big. A lot of people like to read a series. In fact, I just talked to an author yesterday that Gina has read the first 12 books and is like anxiously awaiting 13. And okay. And she did the, well, I'll check it out. And like, oh, now I got to have all of them. You know, and when I was younger, I read Dragonlance and I loved Dragonlance. So sitting on my shelf, I've got like 20 some Dragonlance, and that's not even all of them.
Right.
You know, we've talked about series, but you also talked about covers and how big that is. And that's a big thing for authors. The first thing authors want is, I want something different. I want to, you know, have something that's unique, and that's not what you need. I do the same thing. I look at the cover, and you're right, it's stupid, but if I see a cover that appeals to me, that's going to make the book better for me, or I hope it is, you know, exactly. And that's exactly what they do. Let me ask this of you.
Enough to blend, but to stand out, you know what I mean? That you can see that it's in the genre and it's good to be good at that, but that it's got a new take on it. You know what I mean?
And so that's exactly why for my stuff right now, I got Tom Zoller to draw the cover. It's a middle grade fiction. It's got a drawn cover. It's got a boy on it. It shows a wizard, you know?
Yeah.
The scene I even looked at and I'm like, oh crap, I didn't give him enough detail. He's got the hero fighting the main wizard and the other guy hiding. That's not how the book goes.
That's not how it goes.
It conveys, you know, hey, You know, if you've read other books with covers similar, grab this one, you know.
Exactly.
What, let me ask this, things like Star Trek that you watch a TV show or you see a movie, do you then like to go read the books associated with it or the novelization of the movie or anything like that?
Honestly, I don't do that as much as I once did. When I was young, I really liked that genre so much that I not only watched the Star Trek show and the animated show, but I read the novelizations of them. And often the authors were skilled enough, like Alan Dean Foster was one, James Blish, that they added things to. So whatever you could only get in an hour worth of TV show, they added backstory, they added context and all kinds of good additional characterization of what's going on. And so I liked those. But then I must have read enough novelizations that were just, oh, that's the movie. There's nothing added to it. And so I wasn't getting the satisfaction out of it. I felt like that was a place where it wasn't being written by an author. It was being written by a marketing committee. And they were saying, hey, there's another part of the market that we can appeal to if we have the movie and the book and the poster and the game. And I didn't want to feel like I was the willingly fleeced fan that had to have everything of that kind of stuff. So I don't know that I read those so much anymore. I like it where they take a series and they have additional books to it. So Star Trek started to do it that they weren't novelizations of the episodes, but original works. And I discovered all kinds, like Peter David, I'm trying to think of other authors that I really seemed to get it. You know, like Doctor Who had all kinds of novelizations. And then they also had people that were, I think, writing new works. And I really like the fact that when you can see someone that, I don't know, they loved it as much as I did, but they had also the creativity to say, well, what was going on in between this episode and this episode? And so I really have respect for that. Some of the series that we've talked about where, well, you know, Brian Herbert is continuing the Dune books from his father, Frank. With Kevin Anderson. And they're quite good. And the first one I read was like, I hope this isn't a cash grab. I hope this isn't, you know, and yet they captured, again, the essence of what made the book good, the vocabulary, the understanding of the characters, but filled in things that hadn't been addressed enough in the books in some way. So it was a very satisfying thing to have the backstory filled in or to have things alluded to that instead, here's you heard all about the Android revolution or whatever else it might be, you know?
Right.
I think that I have read so much that that phenomenon doesn't happen. Most often I've read the book first before the movie comes out instead of the other way around. You know what I mean? So all the Harry Potters I had read and et cetera, et cetera. We can start naming all the things that when it finally becomes a movie, it's like, well, I kind of have been waiting. I've been waiting for them to make that. A whole bunch of comic books that have become movies, they had to wait for the special effects and the size of the scope of what they were able to do to match what you can do in comic books. You
know, arguably, what I mean? Too, I would say comic book movies, they had to capture the right feeling, not always, not just special effects. That was huge. It had
absolutely
to, you know, look like it, but it really, you know, I think before Iron Man, they treated comic book movies as, oh, this is just a kid's thing, you know, whatever.
Yes.
But they took it seriously. And it's like, okay, we don't want to make a comic book movie for kids. We want to make an adult movie that people can enjoy regardless of reading comics. And I think that was a big change. Mindset change. Are you one of those with a book that if a movie comes out that looks really good based on a book and you haven't read it, are you one of those that you got to go get the book and read it first?
I have done that. I'm trying to think what an example of that might be. You know, where I really did, I wanted to have the backstory to the characters and kind of my own idea of what was going on there. Okay, most things get made where the character in the movie is good enough compared to the character in the book. Once in a while, it hits with such a thud. It's like, we're rereading the same book? That isn't at all right. What I pictured in my mind. That isn't how for instance, there's in the first Dune movie, which is, you know, kind of like reviled because it so much didn't match the tone of the books. And which it amazes me to see Frank Herbert's name in the credits as a consultant, because how did he miss? Like, it's not Fremen, it's Freeman. That's, you know, anyway, and there's a great scene with someone cries at a funeral and on a desert planet giving water to the dead is an incredible thing. It's a very moving thing. And when they see want to first do it. It really is a huge scene in the books. And in the movie, it was just like, they didn't make anything out of the impact of it that it had in the book. So why? Why did they miss such a pinnacle of the book?
I've talked to some other people about this. We've talked about it, that the movies have always been, a big movie. That's great that this book got turned into it. But more and more, they're making 8-10 episode TV shows with huge budgets. And more authors are going, you know what? Those TV shows are much more interesting than the movies because they get time to explore. They can really get into it in depth and really capture people.
I am absolutely in that camp nowadays. You know what I mean? Especially with the advent of, you don't have to cater to lowest common denominator. There's only 3-5 major networks. You can have every single niche addressed on Netflix and Amazon and Hulu and wherever else you want to go to.
HBO.
Exactly. So, man, I discovered that I have HBO Max. I didn't want to pay for it because I already had 2 Infinities from Amazon Prime and Netflix. And you know what I mean? I already had Aleph, Null, and One. I don't know that I need another. And yet, HBO Max has Doom Patrol. HBO Max has
Titan. HBO Max is pretty impressive.
And, oh, man. Doom Patrol, they've so much very well captured the Grant Morrison version of the Doom Patrol, which was quirky and funny and terrifying. And it was so, so good at capturing what it is to have freaks be heroes, that the public is never going to thank you for saving the world. They're going to thank you for saving the world and then say, yeah, but get out of here. You kind of unnerve me. You know what I mean? And they make allusions to all the past of Doom Patrol because it has been through like 7 different incarnations in comic books over the course of time. And they don't do it to make fun of them or to dismiss them. They really say, well, what was the good elements of those kinds of things? And that's what kind of informs this current version of them. Whoever's writing that show, whoever's the showrunner, they really get it. And I'm just so happy.
And that's so important. And you were talking earlier about that books people have written based on TV shows, Doctor Who, etc. I know there was a book based on the old MacGyver series, and it was really hard to find. I got it, read it, actually not too long ago, within the last decade. And I was like, wow. Whoever wrote this book must have never watched a single episode of the show. This is all, I think what it was, this author had an adventure type book. And so they hired him and said, just change it to MacGyver and we'll put it out. And that's so not what you can do now. People are very, not only are they smarter and want demand more, but there's more talking about it. There's more networking. You know, if you screw it up, absolutely, there's so many people that'll jump on the bandwagon and let you know.
That's really true.
You know, if it's a beloved property, you can't just throw schlock out there.
Yeah. Early on, one of the joys of going to Comic-Cons was that was one of the few industries, and that's not even the right term, you know, media, where there was very much interaction directly between the fans and the creators. You know, there's always been a bit of remove for the movies and for plays and stuff like that, that it was critics reviewing them. It was, there's just like, more of a, but there's layers, if you will, whereas I was at early Comic-Cons where fans would ask the artist of a book about a specific scene drawn in a comic, why did you do this way? And the artist would say, well, because of this and this and this. And each of them would leave very satisfied with, wow, you really have paid attention to that level of detail. And yes, I really did have a reason for doing it that way. And so that's a very, very cool thing about the world of comic books, is that the barriers have been down for a long time of, even though this guy just made 100,000 copies selling comic book, you know, at that time, very, very good, he's willing to talk to little Billy because Billy loves it and Billy really lives it. You know what I mean?
So, and it's kind of interesting too, because a couple years ago, you would not have seen an A-lister movie star on a Netflix TV show. Now, guess what? There's no movies and all you have available. And all of a sudden, all these A-listers are coming on the movies, on the TV shows, on Netflix and Hulu and everything. And they're really good and people are watching it and subscribing. And, you know, HBO, why do I go to the theater? Because I can watch it right now on HBO the day it comes out type thing.
Exactly.
You know, and the world's totally different, man. I mean, you know, movies are different in the theaters over the last 2 decades than they were the 70s and 80s. And now everything's changed again.
Absolutely. It's cool to have been around for a long time to have seen them things go through those generations of, like, I don't know, there was a time when, if you want to look at the movies made of Stephen King books, please don't watch the first 20 of them, because right. they bought the book, they bought this incredibly well-written property, and then proceeded to muck it up. Maximum Overdrive, it was just written made silly. On.
Okay, you got to admit, the trucks looked cool. The one had the Green Goblin on it, right?
Right.
On the
front.
And you got to admit, what's his face? The actor looking at the pop machine, and the pop goes twink and leaves the mark in his forehead. Come on. That's memorable.
So memorable. And you just named the two things that are
exactly. That's about it. But when I was 10 or whatever, that was a pretty cool movie.
I agree. What I like now is that when you see that there really are many times, they don't just dismiss things. They bring the author on to say, give us advice as to, so we capture your thing sold 10 million copies. You got the sauce. You got the magic. Let's not lose that in the translation here. So whatever they used to do to buy the book and then do whatever they wanted with it, it really seems to be that they're trying to puts it together, or they go amongst too many different comic book series to grab different pieces instead of saying, well, the series, the arc of this story was really convincing in and of itself. You don't need to keep throwing too many villains in, throwing too many references in, whatever else it might be. And I don't know, man, I just.
But what you said about the authors, I think back in the day, that was kind of the thing. And Stephen King has talked about this a lot. People like, well, what'd you think about that movie? Because, you know, it kind of sucked compared to your book. He's like, hey, they want my movie. They pay me money. They tell me to get lost. I don't care. He's like, I separate myself from that. It's based on my book. They could do whatever they want with it and pay me the money.
Right.
But now.
I don't like that. The fact that by him having gotten money from that, he has the life that lets him write about anything he wants. He doesn't have to worry about any marketing survey that says, hey, we're going to need a book with rodents in it because they're big this year. You know what I mean?
Yeah. But then I think now they're discovering that if they get the original author involved, that they can get a better product. And that's what people expect and want. And they can't just screw it up. So all right, man. Well, I need to head out because I got another.
You got your meeting at 11. Exactly.
Yep. I appreciate the talk. So I'll make sure.
We didn't even talk about nonfiction. We'll have to talk about more books next time because we have
still got to do some music, some deep dive into some really good.
That's true. We have kind of an ongoing list of, we'll get to these three things. We only get to one or two. And then it's like, well, we'll do our catch up episodes.
Yeah.
Okay. Have a great rest of the day, Stephen. Okay. Take care. Be back.
Thank you for listening to Discovered Wordsmiths. Come back next week and listen to another author discuss the road they've traveled, and maybe, sometime in the near future, it might be you.